Is it okay to play the lottery? Why was Jesus crucified and not stoned to death? And do adults have to obey their parents? We'll answer these questions and more in just a moment on Line Upon Line. Welcome to Line Upon Line, brought to you by It Is Written with Wes Peppers. I'm John Bradshaw. We're going to answer your Bible questions. They have been submitted by It Is Written viewers, and if you have a question you would like to submit, we'd love you to do so by emailing us at lineuponline@iiw.org. Wes Peppers, great to have you here.
Good to be here, Pastor John.
We have another lineup of excellent questions, I'm sure. Let's take a look at this question from Daryl, who asks, is it okay for a Christian to play the lottery? He adds, I read of a brother who thanked God that he won the lottery.
I had a relative by marriage who won the lottery, $6.3 million, died 2 weeks later.
Oh.
Just for the record, I wasn't married to my wife then. It was on her side of the family.
Of course, and not yours.
We have none of that money. So just to be clear about that. But is it okay for a Christian to play the lottery? Well, obviously not, because it's a form of gambling. You are placing money on a bet that you're going to win based upon some random numbers that are drawn, or you're taking a risk of scratching off a lottery ticket and hoping that you're going to match up the numbers or the shapes or the letters or whatever it is. It's a form of gambling,
yeah.
And you're never going to win with that. It's just not biblical.
Here's the thing. Gambling ruins people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the vast majority of gamblers are going to say something like, didn't ruin me. No, it didn't ruin you, but it did cost you a bunch of money. And it probably led you into some places that were not particularly holy. You know that smoking kills 1 in 3 smokers. I mean, that's a lot. But two out of three don't get killed by smoking. So why not smoke, right? Mainly what happened to you. Alcohol is ruinous. Except there are a lot of people who aren't ruined by alcohol. They're all harmed, but not ruined. The fact that it doesn't ruin you doesn't mean that it's not ruinous. And gambling is ruinous. It ruins economies. It ruins homes. I was in a town in California. Speaking to a locksmith, I said to him, hey, I noticed there are 2 casinos in this little town. It was the town of Oroville, in or near Oroville. I said, how does that benefit the local economy? He said, it doesn't.
Mm.
I said, you got all those jobs, all that money being generated. He said, well, it benefits me. He was honest. I'm a locksmith. I get plenty of work with these guys. He said, but a woman who is going to spend $70 to get her hair done doesn't, and instead she drops at a casino, and the hair salon suffers. The grocery store that was going to sell $200 worth of food doesn't, because that money gets dropped into the casino. So casinos act as a soak to suck up excess money that would otherwise go to better places. Yes, they employ a bunch of people, but that's not really germane to this conversation. And then those who win the lottery. Man in West Virginia won millions. His granddaughter died. He got thrown in jail, I believe. There were guns involved. His life was miserable, and his wife said, I wish we had never, ever bought the ticket.
Mm.
So dropping millions of dollars into a person's lap is not always helpful. Now, someone's going to say, but a lot of people were really benefited by that. I'm not telling you it ruins everybody, but it ruins many. There are very few things that ruin everybody. Mm-hmm. We ought to be able to look at gambling and look at what's associated with gambling. There's a reason they call Las Vegas Sin City. If you took the gambling out, it would suddenly become, well, nothing, actually. There wouldn't be much left. But it wouldn't be Sin City without the gambling. Gambling is a vice. It's associated with evil. It's corrupt. Is it okay for a Christian to play the lottery? What's your one-word answer?
Absolutely not. That was two.
Two words.
No, that's one word.
And God says, thou shalt not covet. And gambling is the exercising of covetousness. There is a commandment that speaks to gambling. We could have done that in 10 seconds, but you know, why take 10 seconds when you can take almost 4 minutes?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Sharon asks us, the Pharisees took Jesus before Herod so that he would condemn him to be crucified. But there were other times the Pharisees stoned people during that same period of time, mentions Stephen, the woman caught in adultery. I don't believe it was the Pharisees stoning them, but nevertheless. Why didn't they just stone Jesus instead of wanting to have him crucified?
Well, you know, there's prophecies that talk about this, that Jesus would be crucified. So that's definitely the primary reason. You know, Jesus was so publicly well known that if he had been stoned, everybody would have known about it. That would have caused problems with the Romans. So they had to get...
They would have known that the Jews did Jesus in.
Exactly. And so they had to get permission from the Roman governor to execute him. And of course, the Roman method of execution was crucifixion. So there's a couple of reasons. And, you know, there were times the Bible says they picked up stones to stone him, but it wasn't his time, and he would just disappear or be carried away by angels.
Took him up on the cliff in Nazareth. They're going to throw him off.
Yes.
No. Jesus was sentenced by the authorities, and the authorities' method of execution was crucifixion. Another thing, too, I don't think either method of execution is anything other than ghastly. I think everybody would agree that being crucified is worse than being stoned. And so no one could ever say that Jesus took the easy way out or the easier way out. It's not like he was shot and died instantly. He suffered on the cross. He could have, and he was tempted to turn back, undoubtedly. But he didn't. So the crucifixion demonstrates the depths of God's great love for you.
Amen.
Question from Kevin. Why is it that in today's world there seem to be many churches, but evil is continuing to spread? Is it that the churches have failed to preach a relevant gospel, or are people just that much more sinful now than they were in the past? Oh, interesting.
Yeah, the answer is probably both.
Bit of both.
Yeah, certainly.
Here's we can deceive ourselves sometimes. There was never a time that all of society was holy and that the church was super pure.
Right.
If you go back into the early United States, you cannot claim it was a pure church. Mm-mm. If you look at the church in Great Britain, just a few hundred years ago, it was corrupt. It was weak. It was powerless. It was not especially biblical. So we ought to not live in a dream world where if only we could get back to the good old days, because the good old days weren't.
Even in the book of Acts, you had Ananias and Sapphira who lied about selling property. So there were corrupt people even in the days of the apostles.
Yeah. So why is evil continuing to spread? Number one, you've got a critical mass now, and evil is just, it's on a roll, and it's not like there's much to stop it. Having said that, I believe this is an interesting point Kevin raises. The churches haven't done their job. I mean, some guy gets on TV and says, I need $55 million for a plane.
People start sending it in.
Yeah, but give money so I can buy a $55 million plane. Thinking people look at that and they go, oh, that's gross. And they tar all Christians with the same brush. They put all Christians in the same basket and say, that's just money grabbing and greed and hypocrisy and craziness. And then you get evangelical leaders who say, well, the only reason people criticize me having a plane is because they're jealous.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's because it's awful.
That's right.
That's why they might criticize you. I'm not against business people having planes. I would admit that for some Christian leaders to have a plane might be a great idea because they travel so much, so many places and this and that and the other. But it doesn't look good. Mm-hmm. And if you're a Christian leader and you're spending $50 million on a plane, shame on you.
Yes.
Thinking people look on that and they say, oh man, I don't want to have anything to do with those numbskulls. And to name it and claim it. And you come to my church and I'm driving a fancy car because all you people are sacrificing to give so that I can be rich. So that's another aspect of this. Christianity has done a very, very, very bad job of presenting itself well, because in many cases it isn't.
Say, for the record, It Is Written does not have its own plane.
No.
We can be clear about that.
No.
But
no, we don't. You know, I had somebody once, we had an It Is Written partnership event. Someone brought a friend. And the friend said, I'm not donating. Oh, okay, well, that's up to you. I'd give it to these guys who live in their big fancy houses and drive their big fancy cars. I thought, oh, that must be Wes Peppers he's talking about.
Yeah, my house was built in 1956.
And I think your car was built in 1955.
Something like that.
That's a joke.
Yeah.
If it was 55, it'd be a nice vehicle.
Yeah, it would be.
That turns people off.
Yeah, it does.
And
it really does.
We don't want to play that game. It's
ghastly. Another thing is that historically, culturally speaking, culture itself kind of put a lot of wickedness in check.
Yes.
You know, it was taboo to divorce publicly. It was taboo to do just to even wear drinking alcohol
things,
or
you can't
wear
be too revealing,
things.
Drunkenness yeah. and public drug use, they yeah. were looked down on.
But in the last 100 years, culture has changed, especially in North America, and those things are becoming more and more acceptable as people are deviating away from yeah. the Bible and church and yeah. spiritual things. And so there's a whole host of things. I would say that many preachers today are not preaching fiery, convicting sermons.
Yeah, right.
They're preaching soft, smooth sermons that appeal to people's egos and this type of thing. And so a combination of those things are causing this very thing to happen.
And we are not intimating that all of Christianity
no.
is a nightmare.
No.
But we're just sort of cherry-picking some examples which turn people off. Well-publicized examples that people see and they say, why bother being a Christian? They're all hypocrites. I think that's a cop-out,
yeah.
but yes. you can hardly blame people sometimes.
Sure.
Sandra asks us an interesting question. Do grown-up men and women, do adults who are not children anymore, still have to obey their parents? A good question. I'll give you some good answers. The answer is yes, with an asterisk. Yes. Bible says, honor your father and your mother. Now, should I, as a grown man, obey my parents? I probably shouldn't obey my parents because they're dead. Nevertheless, were my parents alive, should I obey them? Yes, about certain things. The Bible says in Genesis 2, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. No longer are they under the jurisdiction of their parents. So if your father calls you up and says, I've told you not to wear blue jeans, you should be wearing khaki pants. Dad's got no business doing that. He's got right. no business micromanaging your life or telling you what to do. But you should honor your father and your mother. And I guess when you're at their place, if they don't want you eating, chewing with your mouth open, you don't do it because you're under their roof and it's their rules. If they don't want you using terrible language in their home, then you don't because you're at their home and you're under their rules. You would honor them. But so yes, small yes, but big no. Once you're a big boy or a big girl and you're leading your own family, you should be following God's direction and nobody ought to be telling you how to live your life.
Quick example of this, my father-in-law, he has an old mentality about this form of respect, but for men to wear hats in the house.
Yeah.
I did not grow up with that. I wore hats everywhere. But when I go to his house, you know, if I forget many times, he'll say, hey, why don't you take your hat off and stay a while, right?
Yeah.
And so he reminds me gently. I don't believe that it's disrespect to wear a hat in the house. That's just my own conviction.
But there's a generation.
But I honor him. I honor him and respect his conviction in his house. And so that's just the right thing to do. If they call you up and say, you should quit your job and become something else, well, maybe you're not going to heed that. But as much as possible, honor your parents.
Absolutely right. Yet, when you're an adult, you're on your own and you follow God's leading. That's a good question. And all of us, no matter what our age, should think of how we can still honor our father and our mother. We will have more of your Bible questions in just a moment. This is Line Upon Line, brought to you by It Is Written. Unfortunately, athletes do it all the time. Runners, swimmers, wrestlers, and more, in their quest to be the best, resort to taking performance-enhancing drugs. They do it because without the drugs, they wouldn't be good enough to win. Feeling they need extra help, they cross a line, often leading to disgrace. Christians do something similar. What happens when, in your Christian experience, you're not good enough? Join me for Good Enough and discover the secrets to spiritual success. You don't have to fail as a believer, and you don't have to resort to pretense or cheap gimmicks in your walk with Christ. Learn how you can be all you want to be and all God wants you to be. Discover where the source of power is for believers and how you can unleash that power in your life. Good Enough, brought to you by It Is Written TV. Welcome back to Line Upon Line. It is great to have you with us. We appreciate your Bible questions. And Wes Peppers, we've got a good one here from Bill, who asks, I have a question regarding the Sabbath. You say that the Sabbath is Saturday. Ah, Bill, God says that. Mm-hmm. He says the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Yep, back to Bill. Which is the seventh day of the week. How do we know that the original first day of the week was not Monday? How do you know that the Sabbath, Saturday, was the seventh day? Could have been the sixth day or the fifth day, or I don't know. This is one of these questions that'll bend your brain if you let it.
It'll bend your brain.
Question is, how do we know that the order of the days of the week has never got out of whack? What's the answer?
Sure. We know from history that the cycle has never been broken, the seven-day weekly cycle God orchestrated in the beginning. The Jews have kept the seventh-day Sabbath, Saturday, for thousands of years. We know that the languages of the world, many languages, over 100 languages, talk about Saturday as the seventh day of the week. The dictionary says it. There's many ways to tell. Primarily, the Bible says it. You look in Luke chapter 23 with the resurrection of Jesus. It says that Jesus was crucified on the preparation day. He rose the first day of the week, which is Sunday. He rested in the tomb on the Sabbath. Yeah. And many people celebrate Easter Sunday as the day that Jesus rose from the dead. And so even the Bible makes that very clear. Now, I find it interesting, Pastor John, that a lot of people will make this argument to try to argue with the Sabbath, but nobody makes the argument to argue with Sunday.
It would be the same argument, wouldn't
it? It's the same argument. If you don't know when the Sabbath is, you don't know when Sunday is, we don't really know when Jesus rose from the dead. So it's really not an argument. The Bible is clear. History is clear. Many other sources are very clear.
Elizabeth says, I'm in my 80s and was baptized by sprinkling when I was a baby. A few years ago, after studying the Bible, I realized my church was not in line with what the Bible teaches. Is it necessary to be baptized again? Elizabeth, the first thing I'd say is no. But hear me clearly. It's not necessary for you to be baptized again. It's necessary for you to be baptized. Because like me, when you were a baby, you were christened. You were sprinkled. That's not baptism. The reason we don't sprinkle or christen babies is because baptism requires a choice on the part of the person being baptized. It's a sign that you've chosen Jesus, that you've died to the old life, that the old you is being buried and a new you is raised up to walk in newness of life. So you'd want to be baptized. That's encouraging that somebody in their 80s is saying, I've learned something and I want to do what the Bible says.
You know, I did some Bible study meetings down in the country of Honduras one time, and there was a man coming to my meetings just like Elizabeth, just like you, Elizabeth. He was 99 years old.
Fantastic.
Had been sprinkled as a baby, but never baptized by immersion. He learned that truth at the meetings. He also accepted the truth of the seventh-day Sabbath like you have, Elizabeth. And he was baptized. It was I baptized him, and I was really nervous, afraid I would break him in half, you know.
Yeah.
But he came up, and he had a big smile on his face. He was happy. So you're never too old, and certainly you want the biblical baptism.
It's never too late.
Never too late.
Go for it, Elizabeth. God bless you. Joyce asks, if there's someone living in my household who is able to work and obtain an income, but they're unwilling to do so, do I still need to support them? There seems to be conflicting counsel based on certain verses. 1 Timothy 5:8, if anyone does not provide for his own, especially those of his own household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Oh yeah, that's serious.
That's pretty straight.
But then 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. Are you obligated to provide for someone who lives in your home, but is able to work but unwilling to do so? Here's the answer. No, you're not. If you've got some lazy bum of a 25-year-old son who could work and won't, you don't have to provide for him. Having said that, doesn't mean you shouldn't. I don't know the circumstance or the situation. Look, understand what I said. The question is someone who's able to work. You may have someone who has health problems or psychological problems or whatever. We're not talking about that. However, you might choose to, and this is where we can't advise you, but we can tell you that there's nothing in the Bible that says you must provide for everybody who beds down under the roof of your home. What would you add to that?
Oh, I agree with that. There's a difference between somebody who can't work or is unable or is limited and they genuinely need help versus someone who's able-bodied but refuses to. And so, you know, sometimes people may be able-bodied to work, but they temporarily can't. Maybe they got released from their job and they're looking for another one, and they need a help just for a short time. That's different. But I think the Bible is pretty clear all the way through. You know, even in perfection before sin, God gave Adam and Eve a job to do. He gave them some work to do. And I think that's very important to understand. God wants us to be active. He doesn't expect us to just sit around and accept handouts. Now, there are genuine situations of need, and we want to address those as Christians. But yeah, I think that person probably ought to, from what it seems like here, be prompted to work.
You want to pray and do what God leads you to do. Pray and do what God leads you to do. I will tell you that somebody bludging off you does not help them. Enabling someone doesn't help them. Yet, there is a case that can be made for long suffering. Mm-hmm. Friends of mine welcomed home their son. He was a drug user. He'd ripped them off many times. Family members said, "Why are you bringing that guy back here? He's awful." Well, he has said that he wants to dry out or clean up. They said, well, he said that many times. And mom and dad said, we want to give him another chance. They were angry. And he came home and he went straight. Didn't use drugs anymore and validated their good judgment. It's up to the family, eh?
That's right.
Sometimes you say it's time to try again. Mm-hmm. Getting over drug addiction is very different for someone being lazy and occupying your basement. It's very different. Mm-hmm. Pray and follow God's
lead. That's right. Yeah. It just depends.
Hey, Linda says this, how can I explain to my newly baptized husband how God is a just and loving God when in the Old Testament there are countless battles where women and children died and he commanded their death? Mm. Yeah, it's a big question. When God commanded the extermination of certain individuals or cities, it was because they had refused to repent, steadfastly refused to repent. God had worked with people. He'd strived with people. He'd given people opportunity after opportunity. And then the day came, God said, the world is better off without those people, and they are better off dead than alive. The truth be told, God destroying people is a manifestation of the love of God. That sounds like a very hardcore thing to say, but it just is. Everything God does is redemptive, and he's trying to get people to repent and turn and repent and turn. He'll allow people to get sick sometimes so that they'll turn in his direction. He'll allow people to have losses sometimes so they turn in his direction. And then there are times that God afflicts people in the hope that they will turn to him. So God is love. The Bible says that. We got to understand what he does in the Old Testament is a manifestation of his love. What would you add to that?
Yeah, in Genesis chapter 15, verse 16, God is speaking to Abraham. He says, in the fourth generation they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And so God, a principle you find is that God never destroys until a people or a person goes beyond hope of being reached. When the point comes where they could never turn back, and it's just more disruptive and more problematic and more painful for them to remain on the earth and continue to inflict other people, that's when God in the Old Testament would command them to be removed. And so there is a cup for every nation. There's a cup of indignation for every person in every nation. And when that cup is reached, that's when. Now, we can have no way of knowing when that is or how even that fully works, but God knows, and God does not destroy unjustly. There are 1,000 reasons he may have that we don't know, but we will understand those things in the millennium, that 1,000 years when Jesus comes. That's what that time's for, to answer every question, just like you have right here, Linda. And so I want to encourage you to keep that in mind.
Hey, listen to this. This is in Psalm 78. When he slew them, then they sought him, and they returned and inquired early after God.
That's right.
Back then, there are some of these people God tried and tried and tried and tried to get through to. What option did they leave them with?
Yep.
So
the sword.
he took it to the next step in the hope that there would be those who would hear of this, see this, and repent.
Yeah, all the affliction God brings is an attempt for salvation when nothing else has worked. He tries the blessings and sometimes the affliction, but he does whatever he takes to reach us because he loves us that much.
Victor writes, I had a coworker say to me that police use psychics to find missing persons or murderers, and she said, it would not be a sin to use psychics to find missing persons, murderers, and loved ones. How can I give a Christian response? It's true, you know, they'll call in psychics, and they'll say the body is in the woods, and they go to the woods, and the body is not there. The body is in the barn, and the body is not there. You're looking for a Hispanic man, and then you find out it was a white female. If the psychics were batting 1,000, there might be an argument to make. It would still be a bad argument, but there might be an argument to make. But they have a terrible track record. But be that as it may, why do you carry this forward and explain why we just don't go there?
Yeah, well, how do I say this? You know, there are situations where the psychic is right.
Yep.
So what do you do about that? Well, it's very clear from Scripture all the way through. I mean, you don't have to go far to in looking to find verses, and you may look up a few here, where God condemns the use of psychics and astrologers and those types of things.
Leviticus 19:31, give no regard to mediums and familiar spirits. Do not seek after them to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. It's pretty clear.
Yes. And, you know, in the New Testament, it condemns witchcraft and sorcery and these types of things. So there's no question that God, this is one of the clearest topics in the Bible.
Yeah.
God leaves no room for these things. So the question is, how could the psychic be right? Wouldn't it be God giving that gift? Well, the devil knows where that dead body is. He knows exactly how to find it. He knows how to lead that person to it. And so God will never use the means to do anything of which he already has condemned. He just won't do it.
That's right.
So if you know it's condemned in the Bible, you know that any use of that is coming from another power and it's not God's.
It makes me wonder sometimes, because the devil does know who did it where the body is, it makes me wonder sometimes why the psychics aren't always right.
Yeah, it's true.
I think that's just God getting in there and saying, no, you won't.
Probably so.
No, you won't.
Yep.
And many psychics are simply powered by the devil. Others are just frauds.
They're just doing their own thing.
Yep.
Yeah. Self-proclaimed, whatever.
God will not use the devil to further God's aims.
Amen.
Neither should the police department or any of us. Thanks, Wes.
Right.
It's been good again.
Always great.
And thank you. We appreciate you joining us. It has been great fun as usual. Look forward to seeing you next time. This has been Line Upon Line, brought to you by It Is Written.